So first of all, I want to say, commend you for being here, because you could be home, etc., and you'll be here, and that's to your credit. Although I do sometimes say for you, a lot of ways, it's not my intention to talk a lot, it's my intention to listen initially and find out how you would like me to use our time together. So what we're doing now is set an agenda. Because as I understand it, you're driving this meeting, yes? And I'm here to give you my experience and guidance. So we can either write down a few things that we want to cover, which would probably be helpful, or we can take a more patient wait for those who are a little bit more shy to speak up. So what are some of the things that we might talk about tonight? Can we brainstorm?
I could tell you that a lot of the kids always want to get out and stretch their shoulders. They think that they are in discomfort, I'll say, when they're swimming. And
we're going to talk about shoulders.
Yep.
I got a lot to say about shoulders. Excellent. What next?
Being sore versus injured.
Okay. So understanding the role or the interpretation of soreness. Just keep brainstorming with me. Keep me rolling. One or two more things and we'll get into it.
Balance.
What do you mean by balance?
Frustration versus inability.
Okay.
Trying to gain it and improve it.
Okay. I understand exactly what we're talking about. Victor understands that too, don't you, Victor? It's a subject dear to your heart at the moment.
I have probably a silly one, but
silly?
Body awareness. Trying to be aware. You're swimming, you can't really see what you're doing. Is there a way to help you?
What's silly about that?
Because I don't know.
Let me explain this to you. If an athlete doesn't get in connection with their body, you can't help them too much. Brain dead athletes are not much good. They can do well, but they can do a lot better if we can connect them to their body. Four things to start with. Everyone's happy with that to start with? Now, I'm assuming there's more that you want to talk about, but you're waiting to see what kind of an idiot I am and whether you can trust me. That's okay. It'll take about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and then.
I'll just build a wall if we don't like
to. Build a wall, exactly. Or issue an executive order banning Australians.
That too.
Okay, which one will we do first?
We'll go with body awareness.
That was a great idea, whoever said body awareness.
Yeah,
very smart guy.
Okay, let's get real specific then. I understand what you're saying, but I want to be sure I understand what you're saying. So give me a specific example.
Well, we will try to tell someone how to pull or recover on their stroke, and you can say it and try it different ways, and they cannot get there.
Let's do a little bit of background work here. Learning modalities. What are learning modalities? My coaches can help. Let's go.
Visual.
Auditory.
Auditory.
Kinesthetic.
And kinesthetic.
What was the second?
Auditory. Someone can spell while I get them up here and help me. I need a school teacher to help me.
Auditory.
Coach Pimentel, I can go now. The boss is here and he's going to take over.
How you doing, Mike? Good to see you. Keep going.
So, got a question for you. How do you know what learning modality they dominate in? And we take it back a step. What is the interpretation of the average? There's a statistic that says X percentage of the population dominates through this learning and X percent dominates through another form of learning. What is that percentage? Okay, coaches, help me. Let's go.
I'll say auditory would be last.
Let's say 20, 40. The message here is this. The dominant learning modality, particularly of an athlete, in my opinion, is kinesthetic. Now let's go back to the realities of the pool. Let's get this classroom first so you can understand this. What's most teaching in the classroom doing? What are most teachers doing in the classroom?
Auditory.
Is that the dominant learning? Dominant learning is potentially kinesthetic. Now let's take this into the pool. What's the dominant teaching modality used by coaches and swimmers?
Auditory.
We've got a problem straight away, haven't we?
No.
So, I'm going to teach you how to overcome that problem. Have you ever heard of the word lead discovery? Led discovery is a form of teaching and a form of learning. So I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm going to ask you a series of questions, as a result of which you're going to find the answer. So let's say, what was your first name?
Bob.
Bob's in the water. Bob, I've got a question for you. What angle is your elbow?
When I'm pulling?
Yeah.
I guess on the inside it'd be 60 degrees.
Fantastic. Bob, can you do this for me? Let's go to 70 degrees, and I'll meet you down 10 minutes down the pool. Give it a go.
Okay.
Swim, swim, swim. Bob, how did it feel?
Awkward.
Excellent. Now, is awkward good or bad?
I imagine it wasn't what you wanted.
I don't know, but I do know that when we do something different, initially it feels awkward.
Yes.
So that's awkward is okay. Awkward tells me you actually did something you're not used to doing. Now let's try it the other way. Go back and let's go 10 degrees the other way. Sorry, sorry, sorry. Bob, how did it feel?
Awkward as well.
Fantastic. So I know you've done what I've asked because you're doing differently. Now, Bob, based on my experience, I feel that maybe we should practice a bit more at this angle. What do you think? This is buy-in now.
Mm-hmm.
Bob?
Say we'll give it a try.
Love it. Okay, Bob, for the rest of the night, let's do that and talk about it again at the end of the night.
Okay, so they know they will be awkward, at least in the beginning of that training.
But when I ask an athlete to do something, because I want to change their technique, if they don't say it's awkward, they haven't done it differently.
Mm-hmm.
I want to hear those key words. I want to hear those words. And then I counsel them about the decrement of performance that might initially occur. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So they don't panic and want to go back to their default.
Right.
So we're going to patiently rebuild their stroke, for example.
Excellent.
Now, massive challenge in swimming is this. I call swimming the most suppressed form of coaching on the planet. For two reasons. One, the kids got their head in the water. You with me?
Oh,
it's
yes.
Pretty tough to coach because their head's in the water most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's three reasons. Secondly, they're in the water and you're not. And you feel kind of awkward because you can't get in and demonstrate, and so you've lost the visual component of it.
Mm-hmm.
So you're a bit limited there. And thirdly, when do most swimmers start swimming? What age?
Eight to ten.
Children. Mm-hmm. Guess what the adult-child relationship is at that stage? Authoritarian. Yeah?
Yes.
And guess what? It never changes. I've worked with athletes who've got two kids and still call their coach Mr. King. You with me? It is the only sport I know of where the athletes in maturity still refer to their coach as Mr. or Mrs. You've got a real issue because you start an authoritarian relationship and the swimmers are told not to think, not to say, and all of a sudden you want them to feel for their body? Like, give me a break. I was working with the reigning Olympic champion record holder in 1500 meter swimming, and he was heading towards his third Olympics, but he wasn't heading towards his third Olympics. He wasn't going to go there. So I changed some changes, and most of the changes we made, the most important things I did was introduce the concept of a recovery week. Now, God forbid his coach would ever find out about it. You with me? We run what I call a parallel program sometimes with swim coaches because they're so dogmatic in tunnel vision that we've got to play games around them. And that's not just swimming. So one day he's in the pool, the coach says, "You're looking pretty tired now." After he's back, he said, "Yeah, okay, I've got a recovery week next week." Oh my God. Like, they didn't talk to each other for the next 7 days. It was nearly the end of the relationship. But he went for the fix.
Yeah.
Didn't matter. So you've got a few challenges there. Now, I'm covering a lot of ground in a short period of time, but I'm just bringing to your attention. You can change your modality, but you're going to have to change your culture. This is one sport where there's a belief that you tell, they listen, they do, they shut up, they don't have an opinion. The greatest challenge in swimming is the dynamic of a relationship when they get an opinion, when they want to have an opinion, and you don't want them to have an opinion, because you still want them to be that 8-year-old who just shut up and did what they were told. You know, there's a real battle there in the mid-teens, and results in most of them quitting. Because they feel suppressed in their opinion. Anyway, I've digressed.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Not for digressing, but for the explanation.
Yes. So I'm helping you be a better coach, ideally. But we're still talking about it, aren't we?
Yes.
We're not actually doing it. So for me to fulfill what I just told you, we role-played a bit. So you got some kinesthetic feeling. So we did do a bit of it. But definitely, you've still got to go out and practice it. To shift your teaching style from auditory to kinesthetic, and to help them get in touch with their bodies by asking them questions. How did that feel? Should be the most common question you ask them. Or how do you feel? How did that feel? How are you today? Open-ended questions. Mm-hmm. Willingness to hear the answer. Change the relationship. So we kind of, we touched on body awareness, yeah? Body awareness being in touch with what's happening. When I'm working with an athlete and I say, how'd that feel? And they look at me and they say, what do you mean? You should know your coach. I want to run. I've got to get them to connect the, you know, their mind with their body. And it's only happened a few times in my career. You know, it's a pretty low percentage of athletes who refuse to get in touch with their body. They're hard work. We get there. But you won't, you know, it's only a small percentage. Most limitations is the way you teach, not the athlete's ability to get in touch with their body. Shall we move on? Lee, what are we going to go to next?
Oh, I
don't
even mean. Two leagues
in
the same issue.
There's two leagues.
Yeah. Well, I think, because there's coaches from different sports here, I think I know I struggle with all the sports I coach, whether they're sore or are they injured, because a lot of, I need to sit out, I can't do this.
Yep.
And you want
to. I'm going to give you, in 1 minute, the keys to unlock that door, literally. I mean, I don't exaggerate, I don't bullshit to people, but I'm going to tell you there is one key that will change this situation significantly. It's not the answer to everything, but it is so powerful. The incidence of that comment is directly correlated with the enjoyment of your training.
The what, I'm sorry?
The enjoyment of training. If your training sucks, you're going to have all of a sudden a lot of injured athletes, yeah? If your training's fun, and God forbid, how could an elite athlete training be fun? Believe me, it can be. Then nobody's going to want to get injured. They'll crawl over broken glass to get into the session. You know, I've been in sports and I've sat down, you know, back in the 80s, like, what the hell is all these injured, what's going on? And I changed the way that team trained over the years. Nobody ever sat out. For me, sitting out is a penalty. I use sitting out as a penalty. If I've got a discipline issue that I can't solve, the penalty is sitting out. Complete opposite. What do other coaches do with discipline? Get them to train more.
Yeah.
And they should, I don't want to swear anymore, but you just don't use physical punishment, full stop. It just should never exist in sport. Because what does it tell them about training? It's unpleasant and it's Olympic. So your training needs to be fun, play-based activity, relevant to their needs, their age, their attention span, their psychology, their home life, everything. And you'll reduce your injury stories by about 75%.
What if it's only on specific things that they're doing in the workout?
Well, guess what?
That's the no fun part.
They don't like that. Now, when I say don't like it, it's not just simply that you might be doing too much. It might be simply that they feel inadequate about that, and you don't deal with that psychology well. Now, I had a girl here, I hope I can speak, I'll try not to be too specific, who sat out of a section of the workout in the last 48 hours. Yeah, she had a story, but that wasn't the story. You with me? There was a background to the story that probably had nothing to do with what she was telling me. All of a sudden, she felt inadequate. So when you're presenting them with a challenge that they don't feel adequate to, or if they feel inadequate relative to their peers, whether it's justified or not, they might have been bullied as a kid, they might have some body issues, you with me? Mm-hmm. The minute anyone wants to sit out, you've got a problem. And you're in control of that problem. You with me? Now, I'm not saying 100% of the time, but that's the first thing I do.
How would you approach that?
You ask yourself, what possibly could be her motivation for not wanting to play? Her, him, or her. Number one. So it's your challenge. There's a saying in optimal education, it's not a learning challenge, it's a teaching challenge. You've got to solve that, not them. That makes sense? Now, at the end of the day, we don't determine whether they become champions, world record holders, go to Olympics. It's not it. We don't determine that, but we give them every opportunity to be that. So yes, you have to ask yourself the question. So let's role play on that specific thing, because you've got an example here where you see a high incidence of suddenly injured.
I do see it, but I'm not the main coach for
the trigger. Okay, but can you give me an example
without
stepping your boundaries?
No. I don't have a specific, I mean, I guess like what shoulders, or someone will be out and they'll just be stretching like this.
Fantastic. But is there, you said to me there's certain parts of the weekend that you have a higher incidence of lockdown.
I feel like when it just starts to get hard, or the sets are you know, it goes quicker, or there's shorter rest or something like that, then it gets hard. And so I guess with being sore, kids will come out and they'll just.
So there's a.
We'll do this, and then it's like, are you sore? Are you really hurting, or is it too difficult? And so it's like, where is there? I guess, in my mind, is it laziness, or are they really having an injury? And then how do you approach that if it's one? And then, like you said, it might just be a boring workout if like another kid or another kid comes out. But what if it's just one or two kids all the time? That when the going gets tough, when it's a tough set, that they come out and they're stretching.
Okay,
or
so remember this.
Hanging out.
Don't rush to judge a person as a lazy trainer. Mm-hmm. There are kids who walk through a brick wall, but they're not necessarily the best athletes. They've just got mental toughness. Send them off to the Navy SEALs or another special forces. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You might get a really lazy athlete, you think they're not going to be an athlete, but that's not the case. I want to talk to you about pushing. In sport and in life, we can push someone, or we can give them an incentive to drive towards something.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the gap between where they're at and where you want them at is big, and you're pushing, what's going to happen?
Push back.
They'll push back. Mm-hmm. If you can bring the gap back and change the incentive, change the motivation for hard working or pushing, then they're more likely to push towards the goal themselves. So you're basically pulling them through. There's a perception in life, in sport, that our role as coaches is to push athletes. The best coaches say this, 90% of the time I hold the athlete back, and 10% of the time I push them forward. And that's a complete opposite to the psychology that most coaches believe is their role. But how could that possibly work? It's the absolute best way to do it. So, there's an opportunity to change how you're coaching from the perspective of getting them to want to do more or want to push more.
Now, would you change the incentive with just that one kid or collectively as a group an incentive for
this
all?
This is a fantastic question. I'm going to cover a lot of ground. I know I'm jumping around, but listen, you're in an individual sport trained as a squad.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I had a really interesting night. One night I was in a hotel restaurant in Hawaii, lead up to the 92 Olympics with the Australian swim team. And there was a massive fight between the head coach and one of the athletes. Just happened to be the athlete I was responsible for. But anyway, and that was a big battle. They didn't want to be treated like everyone else. So this is what I tell coaches. I know you're in a squad. I know you want to have a team culture. But if you don't treat the athletes as an individual, you're kidding yourself. And that happens in college swimming as well, because it affects the team points. And if it comes right down to, well, everybody's got to do the same thing, otherwise we'll create a culture where you can be different. No, treat them individually. So you need to make that decision. But majority of the kids that you're working with, you collectively, not you, but you're taking an approach that is not optimal, because you're assuming you're the pusher. And knowing how often to get them to incentivize them to drive harder, that's critical. How often can we really ask them to work on their current maximum? See how they coach. Now, I will raise many points that will challenge your mind tonight. You will walk out either frustrated, pissed off, or unsure. That's okay. But in the weeks to come, something's going to sink in and you will change. Whether it's one thing or 10 things, I don't make that decision. So my goal here tonight is not to give you the solutions, it's to challenge the way you think. How we travel. I'm going to keep moving. And I know if I've covered a point too fast and you want to come back on it, I don't know if mine, but we'll retrace our steps. Don't have a problem with coming back, you know, because I go fast, and if I've missed or haven't adequately covered, you want to talk about it all, just say, Ian, just go back a minute. Otherwise, we'll keep moving forward. Muscle soreness. Pain is a message. Do coaches want messages from athletes, especially young athletes?
Usually.
I've got a son, 15 years old, training with a squad in the sport, in the strength moment, and the coach said, listen, I'm tired of you whinging. Unless your bone's broken, don't tell me. I'm not making this stuff up. This happens every day in every sport in every country in the world. They don't want to know because it's too hard. They want to hope that you're a robot, the batteries are charged, and you won't break down. It doesn't work. Pain's a message. And we teach our athletes to ignore the pain. And therefore, the orthopedic surgeons drive very nice cars, have yachts in the Bermuda. Are you with me? We just create a lot of problems because we refuse to listen to the athletes. And guess what? They stop listening to themselves as well. So what type of pain is it? What type of soreness is it? Two types of soreness, good and bad. Yeah? But even if it's good, and then too often it becomes bad. So I've used very loose terms, good and bad. I'm assuming you want me to clarify. Yeah? Muscle soreness from an unusual activity is normal. So if I haven't been swimming for a while and I go swimming, I'm going to get sore. Yes? But if the soreness stays, I've got a problem. Now if the soreness goes to a pain that's inappropriate, I've got to put my hand up and say, coach, I've actually got a bad pain. So one of the things I do is teach athletes a good pain and a bad pain. And the coach, what's a good pain and what's a bad pain? Because any pain that stays is a bad pain, even if you can't separate it initially. So even without a high level awareness of what's good and bad, if it's repetitive, you've got a problem. Let me explain this about sport and training. Does using your muscles make them shorter or longer?
Shorter.
Mm-hmm. Is that good or bad?
Tom Brady says it's very bad.
Tom Brady has a lot of wisdom. I'm impressed. And there's a reason he's still playing mm-hmm. at whatever age he's at and how many Super Bowls he's been to. And guess what? Nobody is taking enough notice of it. They might buy his $120 cookbook, but they're not listening to the message. What has Tom Brady said? Heavy weight training, I realised it was inappropriate to me, I stopped doing it and I do a lot of stretching. And guess what the whole strength condition in this country is based upon? Shut up and lift more. Shut up and get me some muscle soreness. Vomit on me, please, so I can feel good about my coaching. And I'm serious. And here's Tom Brady, walking example. In the game, 20 years. The most accomplished quarterback in the history of the game. And he's telling them the complete opposite that the majority are doing. They've got blinkers on. So, swimmer, shortened muscle. What happens when the muscles get short? What happens to the joint relationship?
Stress.
It changes. So you're born here, this is my socket, this is my shoulder joint. We come out of mummy looking like this, yeah? Swim. Oh, I'm going to get sore now. Well, what a surprise. You change a joint relationship, you're going to have a problem. So is it muscle soreness or is it soreness from a joint relationship that's changed? Yes? Okay, well where's the soreness? Now, when they start pointing to their joint, you've got a problem. The joint is a messenger for the muscle. I know that sounds a bit back to front, but the joints will tell you more, bones will tell you more than the muscle. And guess what we do to solve the problem? We cut the bones. In surgery, we cut the bones. There's an epidemic of hip surgery in tennis globally at the moment. They shave the head of the femur. They cut the bone. The bone is just the messenger, and we're shooting the messenger. Now, where's the joint most prone in your swimming?
Shoulder.
And I want to teach you a little bit about the shoulder. Day one, the kid goes to swim, training. How many times they turn that shoulder over?
500.
Day one. Day two, how many times they turn that shoulder over?
10% more each day.
So at least 1,000. Day three, how many times they turn that shoulder over? 1,500 times. Day four. The end of the week, we've turned the shoulder over 3,000 times in one direction for the most part. You know, ignoring backstroke at this point in time. Now, a simple rule about balancing the body is for every time I go forward, I should be going backwards. Impossible to achieve in sport. Impossible. But we can hold the ratio as close as we can through a combination of how we train them in a balance of strokes as well as dry land training. The purpose of dry land training is not to make them go fast, it's to keep them healthy. Because if they're healthy, they'll go fast anyway. So every time an athlete goes to the tennis court and hits the ball with a tennis racket, you know, a tennis player, how many times do they swing an arm in a tennis session? 500 times. A week later, it's 2,500 times. 10 years later, someone comes up with a great idea to do some rehab work. They've got 2,566,149.4 strokes going forwards. What hope have we got of rehabilitation? Zero. Who watches tennis? Have you seen a tall tennis player out of Canada, a male? He's a wreck. If any tennis player at the pro level came to me and asked me to rehabilitate, I'd run so far the other way, I wouldn't stop. When's the best time to rehabilitate somebody?
Before a piece injury.
Not the first stroke. Not the first stroke. So the day they start their sport is the day the injury prevention work has to start. And every day you don't, you fail. So if I had a kid up here that's a swimmer, I would show you the outcome. And you can watch it go from here to here to here to here. Now the children have already got an issue. Self-esteem, bad attitude, and we add swimming to it. And I don't care what swimming program it is globally, I don't care what level it is, whether it's a national squad, there is an epidemic of destroyed shape in the human body in swimming, and it is getting worse. I've never seen so much tape, I've never seen so much surgery in swimming in my life, and it's heading in the wrong direction. In the 1980s, did you know any elite swimmer that had shoulder surgery? I didn't. Did not exist. Now, in the last few years, do you know any elite athlete that's had shoulder surgery in swimming? But 30 to 50% of your national team would have had some sort of shoulder surgery and or wearing tape. So you've got a problem. The minute you swing your arm in one direction, don't swing in the other way, you've got a problem. And you're all part of the problem. Every swimming coach is part of that problem. So you need to start looking for solutions. Because I can guarantee you will create children with stuffed shoulders whose posture will be changed for life because they chose to swim with you. I know I'm being challenging, but hey, I'm advocating for the kids. It's going to happen if you don't do something about it.
Good exercise instead of dry land with open with something that for young kids,
yep.
Say 8, 9 years old,
yep.
What would you do
on swimming? So what are the keys to joint health? Number one, how long are the muscle is? Length. And how do we get length? Stretch. I'll tell you a funny story about that and I'll come back to it. Number two, tension. How do we drop the tension down when the muscle's too tight? Tissue work, be it massage or some sort of rolling. Number three, key to health. Is stability. Stability is from strength, and the sort of strength that should dominate in swimming, because it's not a high power sport, and really it's a unique resistance, is control drills. The word I use, control drills, introduced into the industry 20 something years ago. And fourth and finally, posture. Everything they do there should be reinforced by posture. Now let's go with stretching. When you were training as a kid, did you stretch before swimming? Back in the 70s, 60s, was there stretching?
Never once.
Okay. What about the 80s? Was there stretching? Most of that swimming, I came into swimming professionally in the 80s, and they were stretching. Do they stretch now at the professional level? No, because it's naughty. This is the Inquisition period. Remember the time in history when they burned the books? Well, that's what's happening now with stretching. It's burning. And then I did a little bit afterwards. We're actually going backwards. Stretching. I see what your kids are doing. You get a great education. I believe you're ticking that box pretty well. Now, just because they're doing it doesn't mean they're succeeding. You with me? Yeah. Some need more, some need to do it better, but you're doing it. You've probably got the best stretching program I've ever seen globally here in your club. Seriously. Tissue work. Now, how do you know whether you need tissue work? We had an athlete up here. Who's swimming at the moment? Is anyone swimming with any volume? Sensational. Come up here, please. I can push and prod you. Excellent. Now, parents, if you touch your child, and I'm going to touch you in the chest, if I touch your child, is that sore? Now, if you are healthy, it shouldn't be sore. Simple rule. If you touch something and it's sore, the tension's too high. Change the tension through stretching, and also change through tissue work. So our goal is to teach them to massage themselves or pay someone to massage them or teach them how to roll. But we need to drop the tension. The simple rule is if I touch you and you go, ow, well, you've got a problem. It's really simple, isn't it? It's not complicated. An athlete in great shape, I can jam them and they just look at me. Not a problem. An athlete in poor shape, I'll go like this and they think the world is coming to an end. Seriously. And it's just a continuum from here to here. So that's how we resolve that. Main muscles to stretch, chest, lats and shoulders. Three stretches, minimum. The core, minimum. There's more, but there's Tricia work, same areas.
And traps.
Patrol work. Flutters, scarecrows, external rotations, 3. Demonstrate on your stomach. A flutter is a scapular retraction drill. Hands out to the side. Put your head down. That's it. Gentle touch. Quite bedside manner. Okay. Keep your head down, relax. Floor's really clean.